What's going on, Rushers? Welcome back to Stage Rush TV. I am co-hosting, or my co-host this week is Kevin Daly from the theater Aficionado at Large. This is Kevin's second time co-hosting Stage Rush TV, and Kevin, you happen to be co-hosting on a very special episode. This is the 70th episode of Stage Rush TV.
Well, I'm honored.
And unfortunately, there is no prize for that. I am very sorry for that. But Kevin is here because he saw last week's episode with the ladies from the Creptacular, and he just couldn't resist throwing in his two cents about the shows that are coming to Broadway next season. So Kevin, I'm going to give you your chance. What is the one straight play you're most excited for next season?
Straight play? I would have to go with Private Lives, and you seem shocked.
I am shocked because we actually dismissed that last week.
Well,
I was snoring about that.
Well, there's a reason that I'm very interested in, and it's not Kim Cattrall, it's actually Paul Bruce.
We all know you're a Samantha fan.
Maybe not. Don't throw me off. I'm sorry. The reason I'm really excited for Private Lives is Paul Gross, who headlined the series Slings and Arrows. If I'm sure many people out here have seen.
I don't know who Paul Gross is. I've never heard. Is that a movie?
No, it's a TV show.
Oh.
It aired in Canada, and I'm gonna watch that like now. It's one of the greatest things I've ever seen about theater. And it's a short series. It's hysterical, it's touching, and it's by the people who wrote The Drowsy Chaperone.
Oh, cool. Well, that's going to be good.
And
so you're excited for Paul Gross.
For Paul Gross. It's a coward play I like. Not everyone does, but I find it funny.
It's definitely good.
It's one of the few plays I've actually read and laughed aloud while reading.
Yeah. Oh, that's good.
And that's one of the reasons.
Well, good. That'll be fun. And what is the musical you are most excited to see?
There's a lot of revivals, but it's Follies. It's Follies. Follies isn't a revival, it's an event. And that's how I feel about it every time it comes to town. There's a cast of incredible, amazing actors. And it's such a fascinating show, a fascinating score. It's haunting. And any opportunity I have to see that show, I will take it.
Well, this is my first opportunity, so I am really excited about it. So
I'm curious.
In fact, I hope we go see it, ended up seeing it together, because I feel like that would be interesting.
It's going to be interesting. It's dark, but it tells a very interesting story about using theater types and the musical itself from its early infancy. To talk about how things don't always turn out the way we want them to.
As the mix said last week, fucking old people.
It's about fucking old people.
It's but that.
No,
that
I'm kidding. I don't care.
That's
I like
dismissing
old people.
It. That's like dismissing.
Well, she hasn't seen it either, so we should all go together and have a big, big old theater talk afterwards.
When you see it, I want to hear what you have to say.
Yeah. Oh, we'll be talking about it. Definitely.
Okay.
We'll have you back on the show when that happens. So, today I saw the second week of Broadway in Bryant Park.
Okay.
And last week I was very lukewarm about it, and even though I love this summer event. Today, knocked it out of the park, pardon the pun. It was so good. It was Chicago, Catch Me If You Can, Musical, and Million Dollar Quartet. First up was Chicago, and Melissa Ray Mann played the role of Roxy today, along with Chris Seaver. Melissa, if you remember, appeared on Stage Rush's Ensemble Watch with Chicago, and it was so great to see her play the role of Roxy, and we did actually, but way back when, discuss her being an understudy for that role, and she really was great today, and they both reached for the gun.
That's my favorite.
Obviously it's a very visual, moving number, and you can see that performance on Stage Rush. It was so good. So it was really just fun to see her go do
How
that.
Was Chris
she was
Seaver?
Awesome. Oh, Chris Seaver was great. Yeah, he was really good. He was just very clear-voiced, and I just felt like it was very clear, and Billy Flynn, I feel like, can be a boring role. And even in this small clip of a show, I just felt he made it really sharp. I really liked it. And then, of course, everyone is probably expecting me to talk about this, and you are absolutely right, because I am obsessed with Carrie Butler's performance in Catch Me If You Can with her song Fly, Fly Away.
Fly, fly, fly away.
The show might not be spectacular, I enjoyed it, but this song, to me at least, is mind-blowing, and she absolutely smashed it today in the park.
Goodbye.
It was incredible. incredible. I swear she probably didn't even need a microphone. And everyone, it was one of the last songs performed because they did the last set. And really, the audience reaction, you could tell they were moved. It was great. And you can see that performance on Stage Rush as well. I'm probably going to be obsessed with that clip for the next couple weeks. So I was really happy to see that. So it was a really good day today at Broadway and Bryant Park. I actually don't know how they can top this one for the rest of
Do you know who's coming next week?
I forget who it is. I know the Addams Family is involved in that. Okay. And no, you will not expect to see Brooke Shields next week.
Really? We can't see her?
She's not gonna, she's not gonna come. So Kevin, by the way, I've been meaning to ask you, you are so spiffy this week for Stage Rush TV. What are you all dressed up for?
Well, actually, after we film today, I am heading to Feinstein's at the Regency.
Fancy.
Kate Baldwin did a show there about 4 months ago where she did a tribute to lyricist Sheldon Harnick. He wrote Fiddler on the Roof, Apple Tree, She Loves Me, Fiorello. And her evening was dedicated to his lyrics, some of his songs that he wrote music to as well. And Kate incorporated, he was a special guest in the show. Mm. She brought him out on stage about halfway through her set. And they did a medley from Fiddler, and he brought down the house with If I Were a Rich Man.
Really?
Fiddler. Yeah, he's a wonderful performer.
Yeah, that must have been quite special.
And when he wasn't performing in the second half of the set, he sat on a stool behind Kate, and it was a magical experience because he was sitting there and he was appreciating his music. His eyes were closed, he was beaming, he was moving to the music, and it was just one of the loveliest nights.
That's nice. Well, being that it's his own music and everything, that would be
That's
really
right. And he
special.
Loves Kate, and Kate loves him. Yeah. She really does. And the two of them together was just perfect. Perfect. And the album is on sale now. It's on iTunes and Amazon and anywhere, so pick that up because it's going to be one you'll want to have.
Love your endorsements, Kevin. I loved them the last time you co-hosted. That's an endorsement there. That is an endorsement.
That's how I look at it.
Well, I saw one of your other favorite performers that I know of last night in Sister Act, Victoria Clark.
Oh, Victoria Clark, I love her.
I was thinking about you a lot during the show because I know you're a really big fan, and I had not seen Victoria Clark. Oh, actually, no, I saw her when she was at Playwrights Horizon and that
You
Jonathan
didn't
Groff,
see Light in the Piazza?
I did see Light in the Piazza. That's what I was going to say. I hadn't seen her since Light in the Piazza, but that's not true. I saw her at Playwrights Horizon.
I've seen a lot of the stuff she's done.
But anyway, Sister Act, I thought it was pretty good. I was entertained by it. I know it's not the heaviest thing, but I don't think anyone goes expecting that.
You know, that's exactly how it was for me. I didn't think it was particularly good, but I had a good time. It was entertaining, and it's crowd-pleasing.
So what did you think about Victoria Clark in the show?
I thought she was the emotional anchor of the piece. I really thought that she grounded it with a sense of reality and a sense of truth, and I really cared about the Mother Superior's conflict with faith, conflict right. with change, mm-hmm. and everything she was working through.
Wow.
And it was really something. Every time she came out on stage, it was like, thank you, God. Because it was like being awash with something refreshing. Uh-huh.
I thought she did a really good job. I don't know if I'd go that far, though, as you to say that she was like the emotional core of the play. Maybe because, they gave her a lot of scenes where you know she was able to, they definitely went in depth with this character. It wasn't
right.
two-dimensional.
Right.
I only felt that because they cast Victoria Clark in this big role, which they should have done, the writers, it was appropriate, they felt, well, we can't waste her, we need to give her depth. But it almost felt like they were doing it because they felt they had to.
Okay.
I don't disagree with that. I get what you're saying, just wouldn't go as far, and I felt maybe some of it was forced, but her performance was very good.
Yeah.
With mediocre material. All right, moving on to some Broadway grosses
yep.
here.
All right, first up we have Masterclass and selling 95%.
Strong.
Doing it opened
Strong.
On Thursday, and to some
last
really
Thursday.
Yep last Thursday, to some really ecstatic reviews, especially for Tyne Daly, and they've announced another extension at Manhattan Theater Club.
Good. So that means I have time to see it.
An extra couple weeks
Good.
Before Nina Arianda comes in.
Yay! Everyone's so excited about it.
I love that girl.
Oh, I know, we all do. I just think it's funny, our unanimous exuberance. The same thing happened last week.
With Nina Arianda.
She's exciting. She's a star in the making, and that's the be-all, end-all. Not doing so hot is Priscilla Queen of the Desert at 56%.
Which, can I tell you, that still shocks me, particularly because it's the summer.
You think there'd be more tourists?
Not only tourists, but they have prime, that prime real estate in the Palace Theater. It's right there. I'm just shocked that they're not getting more foot traffic. Yes, it's a big house.
Big house.
But I'm just very surprised they're not selling better. Spider-Man is doing very strong post-opening. I thought maybe after the opening things would die down because there's not talk about it, but they sold 99.7% of their tickets.
Is that still a thing?
I guess it is. The numbers don't lie. But they're getting summer traffic, which is, that's what
they
want.
Keeps people employed.
And the Normal Heart closed out its successful run at 99.7%.
God, I love that show.
Yeah, it was really great.
That production was just staggering. I wanted to go to the closing, but it was my mother's 70th birthday, so I had to go to the party.
Conflict of interest. Your mom's 70th birthday?
Yeah.
Your mom and Stage Rush TV are the same age. What do you know?
Well, almost.
kind of. Oh, man, that's something. All right, well, Kevin Daly from the Theater Aficionado at Large, thank you so much for co-hosting with us again.
You're welcome, Jess.
It's fantastic. Have a great week at the theater.
Take care, folks. This is what happens when you let children speak.
Are you destined to play one of the male adults in Spring Break?
No, I'm destined to be the dad in Bye Bye Birdie.
Oh, that would be good. You would be good.
I don't want your respect.